temporal bone fracture. First, let me tell you about the temporal bone. See, if you see this model, this is a temporal bone. This part. So, this temporal bone has got four parts, which includes this one. This is a petrous part. So, that in case of temporal bone fracture, we'll be talking about the fracture in connection with the petrous part of the temporal bone. Whether this fracture is going parallel to it, is going perpendicular to it. So when you see the picture, you will understand better. So the temporal bone fracture, it usually follows, it's because of severe road traffic accident. And you don't get isolated temporal bone fracture. It will be combined with other bone fractures also. So the patient will be in the ICU in this setting. But in this video, we are going to see just temporal bone fracture alone, imagining that the patient is able to tell us all the complaints so that you can understand better. So that doesn't mean that all the patients with temporal bone and other fracture will be like this. No, you may get patient with semi-conscious state and they may improve in a day or two and they can be out from the ICU after all the preliminary examination, test and examination. So now for the temporal bone fracture, you have classification I'm talking about. You have three types. One is longitudinal, another one is transverse and mixed. Longitudinal means it runs in parallel with the petrous part of the temporal bone. So the blow is from the lateral side. And in case in RPA, the blow is from the occipital side, from behind, it will be a transverse fracture. It goes perpendicular, which involves the inner ear most. So commonly, 80% the longitudinal fracture is more common. And less common is the transverse fracture. But it is not so in case of child. In case of a child, transverse fracture are more common. Now, I am going to tell you the clinical features, the presentations. So, each have got their own presentation, but let me talk in common. And say, imagining that the patient is able to convey the complaints, not in an ICU setup. And I mean to say that he is not unconscious, he is able to convey it. Now, the common complaints will be, after the road traffic accident, he has got severe dyspnea, and he has got a hearing loss, and he has got bleeding from the ear, and that side of the face, there will be asymmetry, means the facial nerve is damaged. So, the facial nerve damage and the hearing loss is more common in transverse fracture than the longitudinal one. So, on examination of the patient, sometimes you may see both the eyes will be covered with, reddish in color, as seen in this picture. This indicates that there is a anterior skull base fracture. Likewise, if you see a discoloration behind the ear, that also indicates there is a skull base fracture. On examination of the ear, on examination of the eye, you can see the eyeball moving in one particular direction continuously, which means the inner ear is involved, the labyrinth is involved. And this is called as nystagmus. So on examination of the ear, if there is a fracture here, when you examine the ear canal, there will be a step deformity. Next, examination of the eardrum. So there will be ear bleeding after cleaning of the ear, of the ear canal. If you examine the eardrum, maybe there is blood collection in the middle ear with an intact eardrum. As seen in this picture. This is the normal one, just for comparison. Here you have a blood collection behind the intact eardrum. Or maybe you have a perforation. Perforation is more common in longitudinal fracture. The eardrum involvement, middle ear involvement is more common in longitudinal fracture. Now, and an examination we can make out facial nerve palsy also. Coming to the investigation. So the patient is admitted already and all the initial treatment part has already been started because it's an accident case. And when the CT scan is done of the temporal bone, and of course it will not be temporal bone alone, it will be the head and neck and maybe the other parts also. And if you see the temporal bone, and it will be reported as longitudinal fracture, which goes like this, or transverse fracture as I have shown in the previous diagram. Now, along with CT scan, sometimes the CT scan, the radiologist still will tell you that there are soft tissue damage and we require a MRI too. And sometimes we may ask for it, especially when there is a facial nerve involved. Now, other than the scan, we may need to do a hearing test if the patient is fit for that. So we'll come to know whether it is a conductive loss which involves the small bones in the middle ear, or is a nerve loss which involves the inner ear. How this is going to help us? In case of nerve injury and facial nerve injury, we have to start medicines immediately, especially steroids. That's why. Now, along with that, we do an impedance audiogram which shows the middle ear pressure, and if there is fluid or if there is blood collection, we can make out with this impedance audiogram. And in case the facial nerve is damaged, we need to do a facial electrodiagnostic test, and usually it is done on day 10 or within 2 weeks. And especially so if the facial nerve palsy is increasing in grade, or if it is a complete palsy which is not improving. I'll come to that again. So that is about the investigation. As I've already mentioned, the treatment has already started as soon as the patient lands in ICU. So we have to follow the ABC protocol, that is airway, breathing and circulation, and of course the spinal injury also be taken there. And then comes the role, then comes the examination of the temporal bone. What has to be done for that? So we have already examined the head and neck completely and the neurological examination. And on examination of the ear, if there is a mild bleed, nothing more to be done. It will stop by itself. But if it's a severe bleed, which is not getting controlled, then we have to do a suction under strict aseptic precautions, and we'll place a antibiotic soaked ear wig to control the bleed. Otherwise, we will not place anything in the ear. Because in case there is a dural tear, that is the covering of the brain, if there's a tear and there is a CSF leak, and if we happen to keep a earwig, there's a high possibility the patient may develop a meningitis. That's why we try to avoid that. But in case of severe bleed and which has not been able to control, then we need to place an earwig. Now, coming to the facial nerve palsy and the nerve damage and resulting in hearing loss. In these two conditions, we have to start steroids immediately. If you don't start at the earliest, the prognosis of the result is not going to be good. That's why we have to start earlier. And suppose the CT scan has been, they report as the middle ear, the small bones, it is fractured. But there is no associated vertigo, only a hearing loss. That can be managed later on, say after a period of 3 months. But in case there is a middle ear bones fracture and it is displaced into the inner ear and the patient has got severe vertigo, in that case the patient has to be taken up for surgery. Then coming to dizziness, that is one of the common presentations. These patients, dizziness can be because of concussion, which comes down by itself with conservative management, with injection stemitel and other injections and diamond hydrinate and medicines like that. But suppose he has developed a condition called benign paroxysmal positional vertigo, which in simple terms means that whenever the patient is in a particular head position, he gets vertigo. We can treat it with simple bedside exercises without any medication. And last, the CSF leak. The CSF leak, it's first managed conservatively. Means first we advise for head and elevation, like 30 degrees to whatever degrees. And we ask the patient not to strain a lot, then not to sneeze, avoid sneezing and cough, and medication be given for that. If suppose he happened to sneeze, open the mouth and sneeze, not to wear a tight neck garments. And in spite of all this, it's not getting controlled, already he's getting steroid, and he'll get a small tablet called Diamox so that the CSF production is less. And in spite of this, still he is not getting, the leak is not getting controlled. Then in the site of spinal anesthesia, we'll put a small drain. These are the conservative management. So at this stage, I want to tell you, there's a condition called sympathetic hearing loss, which means that during the time of accident, when you have done a hearing test, his hearing loss is mild, or you can say only 20-30%. But when he's getting cured and he's okay, when he goes back to work, with due course of time later on, his hearing loss keeps on increasing. This is actually related to an immunological problem which has been precipitated because of the road traffic accident. So that type of hearing loss can also be there. So initially, when the hearing loss is, he doesn't have much of hearing loss, that doesn't mean that he is going to improve and it is going to be like that. So there is a possibility that he may develop a sympathetic hearing loss later on. Now, coming to the late management, the late complications, let us see one by one in short, in simple terms. So the first one is if the patient has got bleeding or blood collection behind the eardrum, which the picture looks like this. In that case, we had to put a small incision in the eardrum, remove all the blood clot, and we had to put a small tube in the eardrum, which will be there in place for 6 months to 1 year period, so that the inner mucosa of the middle ear, it becomes a normal later on. If there is a eardrum hole or a perforation which is of a big size and doesn't peel up even after a period of 3 months, we have to take up for surgery and we have to place a graft. See, this is a eardrum which is lifted and we are feeding a graft below that so that it heals. At the same time, we will examine the middle ear bones too. So this is a picture of a intact 3 middle ear bones. Here you have the missing part of one of the bones. So we have to reconstruct that. So the surgery will be tympanoplasty plus or minus ossicular reconstruction or ossiculoplasty. Now, when the patient got dizziness, I have already mentioned how we manage initially. So in spite of that, he still has, say, about after 10 days or so, we have to help him so that we help the central system, which usually comments it. So we had a central system, we do rehydration therapy for that. So let me tell you in a simple words, few pictures let me show you. It starts with eye movements alone in different direction, followed by neck movements. Then he'll be sitting in that position, he has to turn to the left and right, followed by then he gets up from the chair, standing and sitting down, and each he has to do several times. Then he'll try to bend forwards and look upwards like this. Then he'll be playing with the ball, throwing the ball on all sides and throwing the ball from one hand to the other hand and moving the head simultaneously. Likewise, we'll advise him to move around in a room in a circular manner, and we'll advise him to walk up the stairs and come down. So these are the simple exercises to help the central nervous system to for compensation of the imbalance. So we have seen few of the complications here. So we have dealt with the hemotympanum, the blood behind the eardrum, and the hole in the eardrum. And if there's a facial nerve palsy after 2 weeks, and the facial diagnostic test shows 90% damage, then we have to expose the facial nerve by surgery and remove the covering of the facial nerve. And the CT scan may help us to locate the area, and we have to completely remove, decap the area completely, so that the facial nerve is exposed, so that it is not under pressure, and if there is any bone impinging on it, that has to also be removed, has to be moved free. Now, ossicular reconstruction I've already mentioned, and in case of severe CSF leak, which is failed to be controlled even after conservative management, and if it's big enough, we have ENT and maybe combined with neurosurgery, and it depends upon the approach, different approaches also, we have so many approaches for that. And first we'll try to do endoscopically, if not, we'll take a help of a neurosurgeon, and we have to repair the covering of the brain, which is called the dura mater. We have to repair, it's called the dural repair, and we need to obliterate the mastoid sometimes, but mainly it will be the dural repair which will be done. So this is about temporal bone fracture. Thank you so much.